ब्रह्मां गुरुर् विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः The Sadhana Panchakam. The first was Vedo Nityam Adhiyatam Taduditam Karma Swanushtiyatam Teneshasya Vidhiyatam Apachitihi Kamye Matistyajyatam Papaugha Paridhuyatam Bhavasukhe दोषोनुसंधीयताम् आत्मेच्छाव्यवसीयताम् निजगृहात् तूर्णं विनिर्गम्यताम् संगसत्सुविधीयताम् भगवतो भक्तिर्दृढाधीयताम् शान्त्यादिपरिचीयताम् दृढतरम् कर्माशु संत्यज्यताम् सद्विद्वानुपसृप्यताम् प्रतिदिनं तत्पादुका सेव्यताम् ब्रह्मैकाक्षरमर्थ्यताम् श्रुतिशिरो वाक्यं समाकर्ण्यताम् And today we will see वाक्यार्थश्च विचार्यताम् श्रुतिशिर पक्षसमाश्रीयताम् दुस्तर्कात् सुविरम्यताम् श्रुतिमतः तर्कोऽनुसन्धीयताम् ब्रह्मास्मीति विभाव्यताम् हरहः गर्वपरित्यज्यताम् देहमतिरुञ्झूयताम् बुधजनैः वादपरित्यज्यताम् सङ्गसत्सु विधीयताम् दैट् At the drop of a hat, seek company with wise men.
Bhagavato bhaktir drudhadhiyatam and have firm devotion in the Lord. Then shantyadi parichiyatam drudhataram. Cultivate positive qualities, virtues
like. Shanti, like austerity, like dhruti, like peace, etc., etc. Dhrataram karmashu santyajyatam.
With firmness, give up
all actions which are prompted by desires. Remain extremely alert. And as I said yesterday, this alertness is not something to be created. It happens. And how does this happen?
The more our mind becomes free of all attachments, free of all memories, subconscious impressions,
as a result of that,
the alertness comes about.
You can't see
when you put a culture in a warm milk, you can't see when it is becoming yogurt. But you get the result as yogurt, isn't it? So what did you need there?
You needed the milk to be hot at the right temperature.
Not too hot, not too cold.
You needed a culture which was alive. You put the culture and you do not shake the pot. If you shake the pot,
you will not get yogurt next day.
Similarly, do the tapasya, come to the right temperature inside, do not move, introduce a culture of divine thought and sit. And let it cook, let it
work
itself out, and the result will be meditation,
result will be contemplation,
result will be alertness,
result will be awareness. Yes.
Even though it is not a result, but it's that's how we speak.
Karmashu santyajyatam, renounce all desire prompted activities.
Sadvidvanupasrupyatam.
Here.
Sadvidvanupasrupyatam.
So what is sadvidvan? Before it was told sanga satsu vidhiyatam. Now it is being told sadvidvan. Vidwan means intelligent people, those who are well versed in scriptures.
Vidwan means intelligent.
More than a wise man. And what do? You come close to them, you sit
with them, you study at their feet, you take the instructions and follow their pratidinam, every day. Tat paduka sevyatam.
Last week, yesterday I explained to you sadvidvan as that vidvan, that, see, realized masters are few types. If we
can categorize them. Some are
avdhutas. They are body disidentified.
So, jivan mukta purusha, one who has realized while living, we are talking about them. So some are continuous, some are
avdhutas. The others are, they know they are the truth, but they are not able to communicate it. They remain in silence. And
such are yogis, or I'm telling you in general. I'm not saying what you have experienced, but in general. And the best among all of them are Shrotriya Brahma Nishta Purusha. Shrotriya, the one who is well versed in scriptures.
Brahmanishtha, having followed the injunctions of the scriptures, he has realized himself,
is established in Brahman,
following the path as dictated by the scriptures, and is able to Shrotriya. Shrotriya means not only he has studied the scriptures, but is able to communicate that infinite reality which is beyond the mind and speech, is able to communicate it to other people also.
So sad vidvan upasrupyatam.
So who is this vidwan who is very intelligent, who is well versed in scriptures? Vidwan means
a pandit, full of knowledge. But and sad sad means sat.
So
he and established in truth.
Find such a person, sit at his feet, and tat paduka sevyatam, because he alone can help you to remove the cobwebs from your mind, the wrong notions, the wrong angle with which we are interacting with this divine
which is everywhere, but thinking that there is the divine is far away,
and becoming miserable there
thereafter. Brahmaikaksharam
arthyatam. Shruti Shiro.
This Brahman
is indicated by the syllable Om. So, arthyatam, the Shrutis say
that Om represents
the reality, and therefore contemplate on the meaning of Om. What is its significance?
What does it mean? What is its impact? Experiment.
Without that, you will not come to know. Merely hearing.
Until unless you don't apply it in yourself
on a daily basis, it will not work. And you have to find ways.
That will come through scriptures only. You have to find ways, different angles from all
different sides. Why Om is important? why chanting it is important, why contemplating on it is important, why Brahman is important. Okay, I am absolutely convinced I want to realize in this life. Why is that, has it not happened? Why has it taken, I'm using the word why, even though Swamiji says do not ask why.
It takes its own
time. But if you think that way, that it takes its own time, then it will take time. How much time does it take for a wave to realize it is water? Instantaneous, it's already. Even that thought that I have to realize that I am water, for it is a digression from its nature, isn't it? For the wave. How much time does it take for you to realize you are the divine, the Brahman? You are already. But you are not giving your obsession of being somebody. This obsession has to be given up. How much time does it take? The day you decide. But you are not deciding. You are not putting all your eggs in one basket called Brahman. You are enjoying the omelette, the scrambled egg, all the different types, you know. And that is the world. The variety is the world. And you are enjoying that. Still, that is why it is not taking place. Vakyam samakarnyatam. And listen in depth the declaration of the Upanishads. Upanishads are those parts of the Shruti, of the Vedas, which directly indicate the truth. And therefore, having listened in depth, what did I say yesterday? What is listening in depth? Shravanam. What did we say yesterday about Shravanam?
Active listening.
What does it, how it is to be practiced? Oh my God.
Listening.
Then, we practice that later.
You can't practice Shravanam later. Shravanam is in the moment, in the now.
Listening.
You are listening now. You can't listen afterwards.
Teacher.
Yes, all those, but what is the main? You have to be aware of the principle because of which listening is taking place. At this moment, not afterwards. That is active listening. What did I say yesterday? The knowledge is transferred from consciousness to consciousness. It is not transferred from word to the ear, from the mouth to the ear, through words. They are just medium. They are going on. Some blabbering will go on. But where is your attention? Is your attention on the words? Is your attention... Oh my God, I just missed. What did you say, Swamiji? Can you repeat it again? That means you are not available.
Is this the same as being aware of awareness?
No.
No, it's different.
No.
I think I need more elucidation here.
No, there is nothing to elucidate.
No.
You have to just be. Be that one who is in whose presence listening is taking place. So your attention is not on the words, your attention is on that because of which words are being heard. Because that is the goal. Consciousness is the goal, isn't it? So why are you focusing on the thoughts? Because when you hear these words that are coming out of my mouth, you accept them as thoughts in your mind, isn't it? So when they fall on your ear, it creates a thought in your mind. So is your attention on the thoughts? Or is your attention on the conscious principle, which is you, in the presence of whom this thought formation is taking place or listening is taking place? This will lead to being aware of awareness. When that happens, then nothing will be there.
Then this question also will not be there.
What sadhana is, that also will not be there.
And everything will...
As you know it, everything will vanish. Then what will? Only you will be there. That's scary. I can't interact with
anyone afterwards. That thought also will not be there. That is only because you are not there.
वाक्यार्थश्च विचार्यतां श्रुतिशिर पक्षसमाश्रीयतां. Reflect upon the meanings of the commandments of the Upanishads. वाक्यार्थश्च विचार्यतां, विचार्यतां is contemplate, think,
reflect. श्रुतिशिर पक्षसमाश्रीयतां
and take refuge in the truth of Brahman given in the Upanishads. Dustarkatsu viramyatam. This is our habit. Instead of reveling in the divine theme, we revel in arguments
about the divine.
We revel in the arguments about the divine. I believe in Advaita. I believe in Dvaita. I believe in Kundalini. I believe in Kriya. I believe in this. I believe in that.
Forget it.
Do not get involved
in anything. Any of these perverse arguments.
But follow Dustarkat Suviramyatam Shruti Shruti Mataha Tarko Anusandhiyatam and follow the discriminative rationale of the Shruti. Meaning, follow the way
Upanishads tell you to think rather than independent thinking.
This is my revelation. It was revealed to me.
I was in the presence of God
and He revealed. Big ego trip. Very, very big ego trip. Now, you... Majority of the compositions, if you see in our scriptures,
they don't have an author.
It was revealed to saints and sages.
But they don't say that it was revealed to us. Whatever their name was,
they never
write their name.
Because they have come to this recognition that
whatever is being revealed is not, it is by the grace, it is not my creation.
It is not because of my thinking. Thinking is employed, yes, but the
revelation is always by grace.
Brahmasmiti vibhavyatam haraha garva parityajyatam. Brahmasmiti vibhavyatam. Always be absorbed in the disposition,
Aham Brahmasmi,
I am Brahman, Brahma Asmi. Iti. Iti means thus, having done the 8
points before and all those before, two verses, come to this conclusion by deep contemplation on the
scriptures, without arguing, without reveling in
perverse arguments.
What you should be absorbed in, what you should be reveling in, that
I am essentially Brahman.
I don't have the experience
yet, but I am Brahman. Why?
Scriptures say so. Why? Masters say so. Why? Because saints and sages have realized so. So keep, even if our experience of life is contrary, it is only because we are not convinced yet that we are that one reality.
All-inclusive reality.
So keep impressing on the mind. And it is not that you are repeating, Aham Brahmasmi, Aham Brahmasmi, Aham Brahmasmi, no.
Just in the background.
Anytime challenges come, anytime difficulties come, anytime excitement comes, anytime ecstasy comes,
anytime beautiful revealing thoughts come to your mind,
siddhis come, uncalled for success comes, people come and help, everything is okay. All that is okay.
Thank you, yes, no, all that has to go. But inside the background,
the foundation must be Aham Brahmasmi. All this is, all there is the Self, the Brahman.
The total. Brahman is not the individual Self. Brahman is the total Self, which includes all.
So, a sun reflecting in a bucket of water is me.
And where is the attention of
the eye, the orb, which is reflecting in the bucket of
water? His attention is, I am not
this bucket of water.
I am not the one who is reflecting in this bucket of water. I am the, actually speaking, I am the one who, that one sun, who is...
That one alone is reflecting in all buckets of water. That sun will be then Brahman. So when I concentrate on only me as the consciousness, then I am conscious, others are ignorant. See? But when we focus
on Brahman, then
in one spontaneous revelation, everything will change.
You don't have to, then there is nothing that is other than you.
Then there is no ego, possibility of ego arising, saying, I am realized, others are not. This will not come. I am wiser, others are not. This will not happen.
It will be a complete, what did you say yesterday? Experienceless experience.
And in this way, renounce pride, give up the delusory misconception,
I am the body,
dehe ham mati rujyatam.
Give up
the wrong notion that I am the body. Pride comes only because of the body. Pride comes because I can sit for 3 hours in meditation, ego. I can give a good narration on the scriptural verses, ego, pride. That I am something in this life. Don't mess with me.
You
don't know how many siddhis I have.
don't, be careful.
How this arrogance comes up, nobody knows. But yet it appears. How does sunrise appear? I'm asking. Don't answer. No, tell. How does it appear? You are on the planet.
Well, the planet's turning.
Okay, good.
Good. Planet is turning,
therefore we have the illusion of sunrise. Actually, there is no sunrise,
no.
Isn't it?
Depends on your perspective.
So this is, there is no perspective.
Whichever perspective you take, perspective will be only in delusion.
Yes.
It cannot be the truth.
No, everything is in delusion. We go little bit above the earth.
There is no sunrise.
Jnaneshwar Mahara tells this. In Mangrita
Anubha. He says, go out of the earth space, no sunrise, no sunset.
Anything seen or perceived is an illusion.
Yes, it is
a reality, you are seeing reality, right now also you are perceiving reality, but because of your corrupted mind,
because of body identification,
because of pride, because of ownership.
That's right.
Because of giving value that
this body alone I am, that divine, you are surrounded inside and outside with divine,
but because of that corruption, we are not able to see
the real thing.
Like I gave example, I don't know here or Vivek Chudamani. You're standing in front.
Today only it happened. After I took shower, I came out. The mirror was steamed.
I forgot to put the
exhaust. And I came out.
Went to make my beautiful hair. Looked. I couldn't see myself. I said, where have I gone?
And then suddenly after, by the time I put the oil and everything, slowly, little bit. But a ghost was appearing there. Because one ear was not there, half the nostril was not there, chin was not there, as it was evaporating.
So that mist
on the mirror is the thought on the mirror of your mind. More the thoughts, more funny reflection will be there. It can be scary also.
No mist on the mirror, reflection is as it is. No thought in the mind, mirror of the mind, the reflection of the consciousness is
as it is.
And and last one, vada parityajyatam, give up arguments completely. With whom? With wise people.
With, but
what about this, what about that? Stop. What it is, we'll see. So first one, vakyarthascha vicharyatam. Constantly reflect upon the meaning of the commandments of the Upanishad. Upanishads have four,
that is popularly accepted, four main statements of truth. This comes in Panchadashi, one whole chapter is dedicated to this.
And they are, the first is the definition of Brahma, reality,
and it is told that the first is prajnanam brahma,
consciousness is Brahman. This is the definition of the
reality. Second one is the
upadesha that is given, the advice that is given by the scriptures. Tattvamasi, you are that. So consciousness is Brahman. You are that. Taking this advice, the student, the seeker, he starts contemplating, comes to
this conclusion. I am Atma Brahman.
This Atma is Brahman. It's only
intellectual appreciation at the moment. That this Atma that I am
is of the nature of Brahman. This is the instruction
Given or
in your sadhana. The student is told,
he is told consciousness is Brahman, then he is told you are that,
then he is told this Atma that you are is Brahman. And the final one, his realization. Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. What Nisargadatta Maharaj says, I am that. That's what it is. So these four statements
of truth are themselves a sadhana.
It's not just continuous, meaningless
repetition going on and on and on and on and on.
Nothing is going to happen.
You have to contemplate. Vicharyatam.
What is the impact of these statements? What do they signify? Whom are they talking about? Some other entity somewhere? Something above the clouds? Someone out there, oh, they're talking about the self in the realized person.
What about you?
No. And in this way,
these four.
There are hundreds of statements of truth. I'm just thinking of one more. It will come. There are so many. But these four are taken as the most popular ones, and they have become a point of contemplation. And when one takes all of them and starts contemplating on them and finds out which one goes where, what is it talking about, automatically contemplation on them lifts a seeker from his doldrums into and brings him closer to his own essential nature, and eventually if his angle of interaction with these verses is in, with these statements of truth is correct, then he gets established also.
He comes to realize that it is this conscious spark within him that alone is expressing through one and all. I gave you the example of the sun. The sun alone is reflecting in every bucket of water. The sun alone is reflecting as light in every wave. You can see that in the on a full moon day on the beach. So don't be that spark. Don't just consider yourself to be, oh, I don't know why, I know I am alive, but I don't know who I am, this, that. No, you are that Brahman. You are that one who, out of his own potentiality, the entire creation was created, and having created and the phenomena came about of the creation, and the scriptures say he entered the creation. He alone is in every atom, in every molecule, in the tiniest of the tiny. He is larger than the largest. Bruhatat iti Brahman means he is larger than the largest, and he is smaller than the smallest. Means there is no place where he is not. That divine principle out of whom this whole creation has come about, has risen. And it, yesterday I explained to you, the entire creation has come out of him, it exists in him, and after destruction it goes back to him alone. There is no other place where it goes. In this way, contemplate. This reality, this conscious principle which we are talking about, which is in its essential nature Brahman, it cannot be objectified, because it is the subject itself without the object. And what is the object aspect in the subject? The thought is the object aspect in the subject. So if you are thinking about I as a thought, then it's not you. It's an idea of you expressing in the mind. But when through contemplation we reach a point of subjective indulgence, these prajnanam brahma, ayam atma brahma, tattvam asi, aham brahmasmi, these are all to make the seeker realize that this I, which he is thinking of himself as, is existing eternally, is there
even if he doesn't think of it as I. And that is his real nature. And that I, without a thought, is not just one per body. It is all inclusive. This point we have to come to. And this happens, the click into it,
in the right direction, catching the objectification of the consciousness as I.
The unclicking out of it.
It happens only by grace.
Otherwise, life after life after life, we can be caught up in it. Therefore, and once a person awakens
to this
self, from that very moment onwards, all objectivity ends, all compulsions
to do something in this world end,
all desires end, all subconscious impressions, they end. Why we are saying desires and subconscious? Because that is how we feel at this moment.
We are persecuted by them day in and day out.
From where they are coming, I don't know. It just keep
mind keeps pumping out thoughts and desires. Where it is getting all this data, we don't know.
This way, Adi Shankaracharya here, with the Aham Brahmasmi, when he comes to realize that this Atma that I am on the seat of meditation
itself is consciousness. I am Atma, is
itself the Brahman. So see now the connection, definition was
consciousness is Brahman. Then the teacher told him, you are that,
meaning you are that Brahman or you are that consciousness. Then the student in his reflections and contemplations came to,
in deep meditation came to realize,
and the teacher guided him by saying, the scriptures guided him by saying that this
Atma that you have
realized is actually Brahman. Oh my God, I am that infinite. I thought I was only in this body.
No, no, you are this, this
Atma that you have come to realize in yourself, this conscious principle
that you think, you have not think, that you have come to realize, itself is that infinite consciousness.
And initially there is doubt, like every...
about everything. Then, but his faith, his dedication, his trust in the words of the teacher and the scriptures,
all that, and continuous application. And what is the application here?
To give up the application.
Just to accept without a thought that I am that. And the awareness becomes aware of itself. And this is the roar. Such a person cannot be shaken from his foundation thereafter. Nothing can corrupt his mind. Nothing can dilute his experience. Every moment of his existence will only
keep adding more and more.
If there is something to add, I am using this language.
It
will only enhance
his abidance. Okay, let's put it that way.
It will only enhance his abidance. And how is that happening? Because he is so focused, he is so with himself, as a result, the mind, whatever corruption of thoughts was still lurking in the subconscious, that also gets washed away once and for all. It may appear, but he is not available. This is the glory of Vakyarthascha Vicharyatam Shrutishira Paksha Samashriyatam. Paksha Samash. Take refuge in the truth of Brahman. Take refuge only in the Brahman. Don't take refuge in the world. Out of habit, you can come to know when majority of the time, 90% of the day, we are talking to ourselves. What are you thinking about? How will I survive? Where is the petrol going to come? What am I going to do tomorrow? All this is these type of thoughts are dictated because we have taken solace in the world. We are still not come to this deep conviction that world is ephemeral. And hence this default disposition in the mind that by getting something from the world, by interacting with the world, I will complete myself. It is not going to happen. Maybe that is the reason we are born again as human beings. You, me and all. This corruption must not have gone in our past life. So, yeah, naturally we find like fish to water, this knowledge has come to us and we understand everything. But some corruption is there. Some debt was there. And this obsession with the world, that by doing something in this world, I will become complete, it is not going to happen. And therefore it is said, take refuge only in Brahman. Your eyes are seeing people, your eyes are seeing enemy, your eyes are seeing a lover, beloved, parents. Continue to impress, it's Brahman. That is why people call such people mad people. Other people call such person a mad. What to do? When the objects of the world are persecuting us and we are available, we become miserable. When the emotions are persecuting us and we are available because we have given importance and value to them, we are miserable. When thoughts are persecuting us and we are available to them, again, how do we become available to them? By giving them validity. By giving them validity, we become miserable. Then to whom do we give validity? To whom do we give importance? To only that one idea. That everything is Brahman and that I am. That all-inclusive principle, I am. Yes, it is a thought, but it is indicating you. You are that, it was told. No? So, make that, come to this conclusion and sit quietly. Let the culture become, make, convert the whole milk into yogurt. Avoid, so instead of being in love with the world, to become complete, fall in love with the Brahman to become complete. Avoid perverse arguments here. What was it? dustarkat suviramyatam. Suviramyatam. Ramyatam, no. Suviramyatam. Ramyatam is indulgence. Suviramyatam is extreme indulgence. Obsessive indulgence. You must have come across many people,
and we have also been culprits,
that sometimes some idea, some question catches our fancy, and we are so much in love with that. Oh my God, my mind came up such a fantastic question, and we keep asking that question to everyone whom we meet, every master we come across, but we are not listening to the answers that are coming. Isn't it? A simple one. What is meditation? We'll ask everyone, what are you trying to get from everyone? Yoga meditation is not something that can
be communicated. You have to
vilify your papad. You have to do the hard work.
You have to control your senses. You have to control your mind and go beyond all that.
But we go,
and we ask, and then we ask this, and then we ask this person. Nothing.
And then we argue. But he said,
like this.
They say you have to
push your coccyx with every out breath, and then energy will flow up. Another says, no, that is not.
Jnani will say, no, there's nothing. It's all in your mind, man.
Get out of it. Realization is not an experience.
Then what? Then, no. You have to first, your body must be able to
handle the experience of realization. So
make it able. How? Start yoga.
Start Kriya Yoga.
And then you argue, but this,
because you are so convinced
that this is the thing. You're not convinced about the truth. You're convinced about the path. Who cares what the path is? Whether you take the direct route or a long route, or you go through the by lanes, important is you reach the destination.
Avoid the traffic.
So where's the traffic nowadays? Yoga. Avoid it. Where's the traffic? In the mind.
Avoid the mind.
Where's the traffic? In the mind. Traffic of thoughts. Avoid it. How do you avoid it? Be the one in whose presence the thoughts are coming and going. Keep that disposition. Don't comment on it. Keep that disposition.
Keep that poise all the time.
But we
enjoy arguments, we enjoy discussions, we
take scriptural statements from here, there, everywhere,
and make it into a big issue. You see what is going on in all over the world. Someone takes jihad as someone says, I'm doing all this in the name of going to heaven and having enjoyment there.
Another says this,
another says that. Oh, it goes on. Get out of,
unclutch yourself from all this. You think about the world, something will catch you, because you have given importance to the world.
How to unclutch?
How to come into the neutral
state? Neutral.
Get into the, think of
Brahman, it will happen. Contemplate on the Brahman, it will happen.
How it will happen, that's not your concern. It will happen. Think of sleep, sleep will
happen. But if you think, keep working out, how does sleep happen? How does sleep come about? What actually happens?
You will not sleep. You will only be thinking about
sleep. But you
think about sleep and
sleep happens. Same way, you think about Brahman, Brahman will happen.
It's that simple. Then, afterwards, you can articulate it whichever way you want. And what's the best way to articulate?
Scriptures.
They will give you the language
of
communicating that experience to the mind. not to the world, to the mind. That's what we are doing right now. Our life, our interactions, our thoughts, our speech, our actions, they
must be guided by
they must be guided by the truth. They must not be guided
by the world.
So there are two ways. Either your mind is
convinced about the world, or your mind is convinced about the truth. We are talking at intellectual level.
What is the deepest conviction? Truth? Then you will automatically
get the courage, the stamina to face the world in whatever it is throwing at us. Because we know we are complete,
essentially. There's nothing lacking in us.
Isn't it?
But when our attention is on
the world, then we'll be scared, we'll be afraid, we'll argue to
try. And then when we go, because we have collected, most of us, all of us have done market research in spirituality, gone to various masters, gone which path is mine or which path is more suitable to me.
We have experimented this, that, and all that data
is corruption because we were not ready to flow with
the truth.
We were not ready to flow with
nature.
And that's what then comes up and troubles us, and sometimes unknowingly we are caught up somewhere and that comes up as an argument. Something we have heard somewhere, something we have studied somewhere, that comes up because mind is stuck there. So drop all obsessions, drop all arguments and maintain that poise. In fact, not poise, equipoise.
Under
all sets of
circumstances, and know that this
principle, this, as we've been saying, this awareness itself is that one infinite reality. Continuing, in the next point he says,
certainly follow the
discriminative rationale of the Shruti, meaning
do not clutter your mind with thoughts of other people.
Oh, you said such a fantastic, yesterday only someone said,
Swamiji, you must listen to this person. I said, what will happen if I listen to this person? No, he's fantastic, you must listen, you must visit, he's going to come to Melbourne, Shriyam is coming to Melbourne
next year. So I said, what will happen?
Have you met Babaji? I said,
yes. Mahadhar Baba.
I said, yes.
How do you?
Because of me?
How dare you say like that?
I said,
okay, I'm sorry. What do you do? But you give importance.
We must have satsang with great masters, no doubt.
Every passing person with every clip that comes on our WhatsApp or every YouTube.
If you keep depending on
others for having a sublime experience. Oh, that was so nice. The meditation was so nice. That lecture was so nice. You are missing the mark. In one way we can say that in
that lecture, in that satsang, in that interaction,
why is the mind saying it was nice? Because it became calm, it became quiet, it became
available to itself.
In that calm mind, the self,
the consciousness was reflecting
completely. Remember the mist example? So that feeling,
it was very nice. Now, you get a, instead of contemplating on what was that, because of which, what is that peace?
Where did it come from? because of our obsession with the world, we say, it was because of the lecture. It was because of the master. It was because of the whatever. Because of world-oriented, we are given importance to the world. This has to change. To change this, we are studying scriptures. Then this over-obsession with the world, making an experience into
a considering experience, which is only happening in the mind, to be a divine experience.
This has to be cut. And only by studies of scriptures. Here it is there. Shruti mataha tarko anusandhiyatam. If at all you want to argue, before it was told, stop obsessive argument. Extreme, what was that?
Avoid perverse arguments,
which do not lead to any conclusion. Then what is an argument which is
worthy of pursuing?
The arguments which are given in the scriptures. So program your mind to think. So therefore, very rarely
you have people call sometimes and I give lectures, but it's best. Bhagavad Gita is a
systematic unfoldment of your mind. This text is a systematic systematically creating a pathway for your mind to unfold itself. Vivek Chudamani is giving you all the qualities that are required so that you become the right seeker.
So you can correct yourself as we are going along,
where
in my disposition I am less
than what is required. Is my angle of interaction with the scriptures,
with the teacher, with myself, with the world, with the idea of God, with the idea of the world, is it correct?
And the more we keep looking at it, and yes, many questions come as we go along, all those questions which you have not even thought till today,
they are also addressed
in the scriptures, if you are patient enough to go through them.
See?
And the idea is not that I want to keep removing doubts. There's no end of doubts.
Doubts will keep coming.
Ignorance is it itself is expressing as doubts.
As long as your attention is on the world, doubts will keep coming.
There's no end to it because world is continuously changing. If world is continuously changing, data is continuously changing. So there will be no permanent solution for this world if our attention is on the world.
But while living in this world, if our attention, scriptures, the way scriptures are saying, if you argue in this manner,
if you contemplate in this manner,
if you reflect in this manner, then
a permanent solution is
possible.
And why are we seeking a permanent solution? To be at one with ourselves.
To be at peace.
The whole running around of ours, going to
India, then coming back here, all this is happening
because dukkha nivritti
sukha prapti. Two things.
We want to get rid of misery.
And we want to abide in peace.
But majority of the people find peace only after death.
Not while living. We are some funny ones who are seeking it while living. But not funny ones, everyone is seeking it. But because their focus is on the wrong thing, is on the world, even though they are doing the right things, they say we are doing japa, this, but it doesn't come. Because
the attention is not
on that all-inclusive principle, consciousness.
And where is that consciousness? It's everywhere, all the time. Be that. And this, with logic, like in Panchadashi, you are not there. With logic, just as in Vivek Chudamani also, the teacher
is teaching.
He, he, he's he will sort out all his these six questions. He will sort out from the next class to today
only, na? Today is Wednesday.
Yes.
Today, I think if we reach that point. But he will start sorting. But it was all preparation so that he becomes available to the answers that he is going to give.
How
he is going to address those questions
for him. For that,
the right disposition is required. And that was the preparation for so many verses.
So same way, in order for the truth
to reveal to ourselves, we must program our mind
the way scriptures are asking us to. We must think. After studying the scriptures,
we should not think, all right,
but the world, I don't believe. No. When we go to school in childhood, when we were young, did we argue with the teacher why 2 plus 2 is equal to 4?
Why sin theta plus cos theta is equal to tan theta?
We never, whatever was taught to us, we were ignorant of it before. It was taught to us, we accepted it, this is the way. Then sums were given,
exercises were given to apply those
equations or formulas to come
to the right conclusion, isn't it? But
we accepted the information
without doubt. Why, when it comes to
spirituality, we accept the scriptures with doubt? When the scriptures are telling
us world is not worthy to be pursued,
why? You didn't ask why when you were in school. About the political system,
about the geography, about the physics, chemistry, mathematics, H2O, why not H3O?
You didn't ask. Immediately the teacher said, H3O, it's something else. But here we think everyone
has got the right to question the scriptures. Don't question the scriptures.
They are the ultimate. The best intellect is that intellect which is continuously saturated with the scriptural thought. That is the best intellect. And that is the best vision of this world also. Urdhvam moolam adashakam ashvattham prahuravyayam. So, Shruti mata tarko anusandhiyatam. Think in the line of the scriptures and come to the conclusion that
aham brahmasmi.
Only by that, by thinking in the line of the scriptures, this will come about. Otherwise, it will not come about.
Brahmasmi ti vibhavyatam harahah garva parityajyatam.
Brahma asmi iti. Thus, contemplating on the
scriptures, in the scriptures way, following the logic that is given in the scriptures, come to the realization, aham brahma asmi, I am Brahman, it will happen.
And here it is written,
be absorbed in the attitude,
I am Brahman. But the verse says, vibhavyatam, have the bhavana. Okay. Have the feeling, even though Brahman is not a feeling. Why the feeling is required? Only when you feel
about something intensely, then alone a deep impression in the mind is created. Understand?
So, right now, we are seekers. We have clear understanding and clarity that we are Brahman, but the
experience is not there. And why is that experience
not coming? Be very clear, alert.
Because our obsession with the world has still not gone.
And why the obsession with the world has not gone? Because somewhere deep in our convictions, this idea is lurking that world is real. somewhere deep in our subconscious. Now to remove, to
dilute that,
you cannot dilute any conviction. You cannot remove any thought. You cannot remove any idea.
All you can do is create a new idea which is stronger than the previous one. That's all you can do.
That's all you can do. You will know this, that sometimes you think you have overcome all the negativities in your mind, but sometimes on the seat of meditation,
something comes up. Where did that come from? I thought I had already worked it out.
So, all you can do is create a new track in which
the mind automatically falls and takes that path. And what is that path?
Aham Brahmasmi. For that, initially that track in the mind has to be created. Again and again. Keep impressing. And how do you... Sometimes it takes many times of repetition to create a impression, deep impression. Sometimes one interaction, I will tell you an example. Someone is driving, enjoying driving, one day they have an accident, after that they never drive. Because the impression has gone so deep into their psyche that they are afraid to even sit behind the driver's wheel. It's gone so deep. One moment. But they interacted with that fear, with that incident so intensely, with so much feeling. And what was the feeling? Fear. That whole rest of their life is dictated by, with regards to driving, it's dictated by that. This is what phobias are. This is what panic is, anxiety is. Deep impression somewhere, maybe in childhood, maybe somewhere they have interacted wrongly. We are not here to work all that out, because there is no end to it. You clear out from this life, last lives will start coming. No end. Then what do?
We create a deep impression in the mind, in our psyche, that Aham Brahmasmi, I am that infinite reality.
I am that all-inclusive reality.
I am that one without a second principle, because of whom, in the presence of whom, everything, this entire phenomena is going on.
But how? Study scriptures, it will tell you. Now don't argue against this conclusion. Now our life should be how this statement which the scriptures has made is true. Now start seeing it functioning in your daily life, how everything is the reality. Normally what people do,
Geeta says that, I know, but you know, reality is different. Swamiji, come to the real world, you know, don't we have responsibility? Are, Geeta is saying,
karma is important, this is important, that is important. But
what are the scriptures saying?
Brahman is the most important.
Then why are you counter
arguing that?
Why you are
leading a life trying to prove that somewhere subtly by default it is happening because of our importance to the world, that
scriptures are saying you are Brahman and you are
out to prove, no, I am not Brahman. By obsession with the world, isn't it?
Otherwise every moment
will be lived with equanimity, will be lived
with that poise.
To see how the statement of the scriptures is true every moment of my life, is that our disposition? In the school we don't give exam or do the exercises to disprove the formulas. Isn't it?
They give you E is equal to MC square, or they tell you to
find out the hypotenuse, you know, in a triangle. You do the exercise, if you don't come to the conclusion, zero, fail. Then what is our failure? Next birth. Where is it? लगे रहो मुन्ना भाई. हाँ बट देन इट रिक्वायर्स efforts in that direction at that scale. If you want that infinite reality, an infinite amount of conviction is required, an infinite amount of effort is required. Then you are ready to go through the rigors, whatever the life is facing, come what may, you are not going to deviate from that point. Point of Brahman, of being the Brahman. Read tonight after this,
or when you go home, In Quest of God. I am telling you three times now.
I know.
Read it. If you don't have, bring your USB.
Yeah, I'll give it to you. If you,
you can bring it. Good. Then you will know what does it mean
to live at the mercy of divine will.
Being, for Papa Ramdas was Ram Bhakt, that infinite reality is Ram alone. And then, be absorbed in the attitude of I am Brahman, and therefore, the more we contemplate on this Aham Brahmasmi, what is its significance, what is its impact, how it is the truth that is there all the time, the more transcendental a thought, the less is the obsession with the matter. When you are obsessed with
reaching work at right time because the boss will give you a hard time,
Do you have time to complain? Our water is not hot, bed is not soft enough, I did not get my breakfast. If it's there, run! I have to catch that train. You don't have the time for the small things. From here, it looks very difficult, you know, I tell you.
Swamiji, where is the railway station? Go out and turn left and turn right. Left and turn right and turn left and turn right and keep going through three sets of light and then turn left and then again right and you are at the station.
Can you repeat it again, Swamiji? Okay, I repeat it. Turn left
and turn left and turn right and turn left and turn, go through three sets of light and turn left and turn right and the station.
Swamiji, what was the fourth one? What was the fourth turn? Isn't it? Now, I take a helicopter and I go up and I tell that person, see, this is the route. So, immediately he comes to me. No problem, because the entire route is in front of his eyes. While he was on the ground,
it was very difficult.
Little bit higher,
the whole pathway is in front of him. Then,
now his question is not about how to go to station. Now, how do I go to Sydney?
Then now more turns will be there. He's confused. Take the helicopter a little bit higher, 5-6 kilometers above into the sky. If it
can go, I don't know, plane. But from there, see, that is Victoria,
New South Wales. That straight road that you see, just follow that. Oh, so simple.
The higher our vision, the less important and clear
become the
lower. And once you come out of the world,
you go into space, or when you are in the plane.
Yesterday only, the
day before yesterday, in Bhagavat, Saturday night, one gentleman says, Swamiji, when I was landing in Melbourne, I saw all these lights. It was so beautiful. It was so
wonderful to
see such a wonderful Melbourne.
But when we come down on the ground, worker has not come.
Machine has broken down. Bills have to be paid.
I have to run here. I have to
run there.
But from there it was looking
so beautiful.
I said, yes, exactly the same way. All those, as long as you are
caught up in the web of thoughts,
everything is difficult. Come out of the web, watch the thoughts like you did from the plane.
Everything is beautiful.
You go out of the space, you can't even see a human being. You can't even see a human being. They are like toys, you know, after a few kilometers. After that, minuscule. Yeah, there's one
email that was going around.
You magnify a flower to the power of 10 or 11, you reach empty space. You demagnify, you come out, magnifies, making it bigger and bigger and entering into the,
after about second one, you enter into the cell. You enter again to the power of 10, you go deeper into the cell. Again to the power of 10, and after 10 or 11 magnifications, there is nothing. There is only empty space.
And when you do the same thing, to demagnify, come out of the, to the power of 10, 1 kilometer. One centimeter to the power of 10, go to the next distance, then to the power of 10, go to the next.
Again, by about 16, 17, magnifying outside,
again there is empty space. You can't even see anything. Once you go and to, and it's such
a beautifully they are shown, our galaxy is also not available to us.
In that galaxy, from galaxy point of view, Earth, where, what is Earth, where is Earth, nobody knows. You can't even see the sun. It's one of the medium-sized stars on which, around which some medium-sized planet is rotating around. On that, we, the seeker, existence
is not even recognized outside.
And
on the ground,
tees maar kha bolte hai na. We have this arrogance, this pride that I'm someone, I'm something. I was in Ramana ashram, I was in ashram, I studied for 2 years of sadhana, I was for this, I did that, I'm a sannyasi. Blah, 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 goes on, you know, it's endless.
I was alone for 2 months.
Join the club. But see how we hold on to and create a new identity. The only identity we must have is,
I am Brahman, nothing else.
Only that identity.
Nothing else.
And in this way, a renounced pride, that was the next one. That was the next one, where it said,
garvam,
garva parityajyatam. Whatever you have achieved in life,
whatever difficulties we have come, think, what do we talk to people about?
Whenever we talk, what do we talk to them?
Our positive and others negative.
That's one. What else?
And
something
pride.
All inclusive.
Our experiences.
Okay.
What are they about? If you, yes. In short, speech comes out of you or communication comes out of you only
about the past or the future.
I should have done this, I could
have done this,
or the guilts,
or
I want to get there, the future. When you are in the present moment,
there is no thought.
In the present moment, there is utter silence. So communication is only past or future, when you are
oscillating between and you are keeping the world alive. You
come into the neutral
gear, what I was telling you before, come into the neutral gear, which is the now.
World will lose its power. And how do you come into the now? Aham Brahmasmi. Contemplate on that. Accept that. Believe what the scriptures are telling you, that you are not the body, you are Brahman. For that, the daily application is required. Do test, practice tests every day, morning and evening. What is
that practice test? Sit in meditation.
Practice test is not in writing. The practice test that I am Brahmasmi is, you take that thought and be that. That is your practice. And the day you get to get the correct answer, practice stopped. Practice stopped. What is practice? Sadhana, isn't it? But don't sit with this or that. Sit
with only one idea, that I am the truth, I am the reality. Not just one reality, the all-inclusive reality.
Nothing is outside of me. I support nothing and everything, yet I am transcendental to both. That is my real nature. Iske liye, the moment you start this, you know, I'll tell you how the mind is. This example I use
it many times.
There is a bucket of water.
You have taken it from the river or pond.
All the dirt has settled down. And you can put that chitkari or some dalke.
So water settles down, the dirt has settled down. And you can use the top part of the water and drink it.
Everything is good. But you want a pure bucket of water. A bucket of pure water, I should say. Not pure bucket of water. Bucket of pure water.
Then what do? You take that bucket, even though you could drink all the water that was there without disturbing the sediments at the bottom,
but you are not happy with that. You want complete purity. So you find a source of pure water, maybe filtered water,
bucket, tap, kholia,
and you put the bucket under it and you open the tap.
What is the first thing that will happen?
As the water pours, or as the water gets poured into the bucket,
the first thing that will
happen is the entire bucket of water will become dirty. Even the filtered clean water is going in, but the entire bucket of water will become dirty. And if you
give it enough time,
as the overflow keeps taking place,
after 1 hour or so,
depending upon the flow of the clean, crystal clear water, you will get a bucket of absolutely pure water. This is exactly what happens with
our mind. Our mind is the bucket.
Thoughts are the dirt. You put in Aham Brahmasmi, you start taking the name of the Lord, you start contemplating, disturbance
comes in the initial stages.
Only in the initial stages. And those stages then
keep, as you go deeper and deeper, then deeper dirt comes out.
But if you stay with the contemplation, keep the source of fresh, pure, crystal clear water on. Don't close the tap. 24/7 in your mind of the divine theme. Eventually the mind gets
washed away. All the dirt from the mind gets
washed away. What is the washing of the dirt from the mind? All thoughts other than Aham Brahmasmi. All thoughts other than the divine thought, they get washed away. Even if they are there, you are not available to them. Why? Your mind has become totally fallen in love with the idea that I am that reality. Then consummation is possible, isn't it?
It's if it's 50-50, 60-40, 70-30, 99-1,
still consummation
is not possible.
it will lead only to a transcendental, sorry, it will only lead to an esoteric experience in the mind, ecstatic experience in the mind, but it will not be consummation. It will be savikalpa samadhi, but it will not be nirvikalpa samadhi. So, correct yourself in this manner.
Deha dehe ham mati rujyatam.
Yeah, which one?
Wrong verse. No, correct verse.
Garva parityajatam and dehe ham mati rujyatam. Meaning, give up this identification with the body.
I already talked about it. And the entire purpose
of all the scriptures. And we are talking about Shruti. If you read the Ramayana also in the right frame of mind, you will see it is the journey of an individual
to the infinite.
Doing the right things in the world. You take Krishna Leela, exactly the same. You take the life of Buddha, exactly the same. You take the life of Jesus,
exactly the same.
Scriptures, with all these words,
all they want to bring about is a shift of your disposition from I am the body disposition to Aham Brahmasmi disposition.
And I am Brahma. So, purify, purify, purify.
Realization is nothing to be created.
Realization cannot be created. Abidance cannot be created. Then what you can do?
When you think of that divine theme,
the mind slows down, mind calms down,
mind purifies. These are different words for it.
Mind becomes focused. And as it calms down, slowly, 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 the what you have become
focused on, that becomes your new reality.
So
now there is new reality. Hey, Buddhu, first you are thinking body is the reality, now in your intellect you have come to this realization that Brahman is the reality.
First you are living at
the base level, now you are living at a divine level, till it consumes you completely.
And the last one, give up arguments with the wise. When we approach or
we are in the company of wise people who are abiding in their own nature.
They say, be a kamandalu. You know what is a kamandalu? You know that pot which sannyasis carry with them? Be a kamandalu.
Meaning, the water has got no choice in that pot which they are carrying, that thing. Kamandalu.
Wherever the sannyasi goes or wherever the master goes, the water keeps moving according to that.
If the water, master stops, water.
If he moves, again he starts moving.
So when you are in the presence of the masters, do not have your
own free will. Be a kamandalu. If they say sit, sit.
If they don't talk to you, why is he not talking to me? I think he's mad at me. Why is he? Swamiji? And then such people come, seek attention. Swamiji, is everything okay? With me it's okay, with you?
They want attention.
They cannot handle silence.
They cannot handle silence. Then they are there and the teacher,
their master scolds someone.
Anjali! How can Swamiji be like this? I thought all masters...
Swamijis or realized masters are embodiment of love, compassion, and this fellow is an angry embodiment of love.
Angry Brahman.
Angry Brahman.
So how is that? Like Buddha,
Gautam Buddha,
his cousin brother was
Ananda. He was there.
So one person came,
and used to stand behind him. So one person came.
Is there God? Without no preamble, nothing. Buddha said, No, there is no God. No, he said, is there no God? He said, no, there is no God.
Okay.
After some time, or next day.
Another one. Is there God? Yes, there is God. He also went away.
Now, one day to one
person he said, there is no God. To other one he said, there is God. Now this Ananda became confused. He says,
Buddha, what is this? You're playing with their... To one person you say something, to another person you say something.
And he kept... said so many things to him.
Buddha said, was it your question? Who asked you to listen? Huh? And this is what we do. When we are in an ashram, suppose, I'm just taking an example, he's going there now.
Tiruvannamalai or to your
Coimbatore. Why are you there in Tiruvannamalai? Because of whom are you there? What should be our focus? Our focus should be Ramana. But where our attention
goes? On the food, on the traffic, on the people, on the politics, on what people are doing and not doing.
Okay. What is your focus? You can never make this
world perfect. World is like this, it has always been like this, and it will be like this.
You cannot change the traffic. People will drive crazily. You have a license, you find a ride, you find your way. You be alert, you be aware of everything that is going on around without getting disturbed. Then you will reach
your destination.
Same way in life, in this world when we are living.
Do not
indulge in comments about the world even for an
iota.
It is like this, it has always been like this.
There has never been a time in this creation when the world has been at peace.
There have been more periods of disruption and
only a few moments of
absolute peace. Ram Rajya was how much? Lord Rama, Ram Rajya, he is the ideal king. He lived for 10,000 years. 14 years was peace in his
life. 14 years! Out of 10,000 years.
And 6 months, 1 year, 14 years he went away, sorry.
Yeah. Yes. And then 14 years he came home,
after killing Ravana, he had peace. If 14th year, again that washerman made a comment and Ramchandraji heard and he sent his wife
away to the ashram.
So the moments of peace
in this world, when are the moments of peace? Between two thoughts?
When are the moments of peace? Every night when
you go to sleep?
Unawares, isn't it? But rest of the day?
It's all activity, all too much data coming.
When we are by ourselves, if you're sitting for 2 hours or 3 hours or 1 hour for meditation, ask yourself sincerely, how many moments of absolute silence did you experience? It will be only a few moments. The rest will be all, no, I was chanting. Well, it was disturbance. Chanting the name of the Lord is not peace. It is disturbance. In the mind, isn't it? When you are listening to this
lecture, sometimes suddenly your eyes close and
you access that conscious space, but very quickly you come out of it again. This bugger doesn't stop talking. I want to be in that peace. Then you get it.
I want to be in that peace. Oh, why is this? Why can't he stop?
This is meditative time.
I meditate with our eyes open. Sahaj Samadhi is.
You are not insisting this or that. Move around in this world, accepting the world
as it is. And how it is?
It cannot be caught. It is the nature
of the world is
disturbance and peace. This, it keeps flipping between the two. Waking and dream and deep sleep. Deep sleep is peace. Dream is extreme disturbance. Waking
is
sattvic disturbance. This is how it is. But if you take the whole, no, sattvic disturbance is nice. No, but you look at the three, waking, dream, deep sleep, from childhood till now, they have been persecuting you. That's not a big enough disturbance or what? That now you want only more disturbance in one state. No, grow out of it. Don't insist on anything. If at all, not insist, be in love with the idea that
I am, the scriptures are telling me that I am that infinite reality.
And I must put everything, my whole and soul, efforts, thoughts, convictions, disposition, meditation, whatever, everything at
my disposal so that
I realize that which
I already am now.
Then the grace will flow. And in this manner, we should not, when we are in
the presence of the masters, we are not there
to validate,
oh, he is a master, you know, he is a good master. These are
the comments that people make.
You know, I think he is realized.
I think that master is realized. I think he is a bit...
A little bit realized.
Still some corruption, I don't know.
How can realized masters behave like this? We are not here to validate them. We are going in their presence to convert ourselves, to change ourselves.
But see what we do, what
trap we fall into.
Get out of that. Someone asked me, well, this question must have been asked to all the teachers. Swami, don't you get tired of talking the same thing again and again and again and again and again and again and again? How you don't get tired of explaining, of sometimes people are asking the same question
so many times?
You can't imagine the joy that a teacher gets when something clicks to a student. That all his repetitions have borne fruit. See? When that doubt goes out of the mind of the student, of the seeker.
Not student, seeker.
That's the biggest joy. What is the greatest joy of a teacher? Of a guru? Yeah, question. Absolutely.
That the student becomes the guru.
That is the greatest joy. It is not a competition. Ajaja, I must keep the knowledge little bit. I'll
keep with myself so that he is always my student.
This is in management.
I experience that when I teach. Clever students, I like to teach more.
Naturally, because they are available.
Some dumb students.
But then,
I can say the same thing.
Some dumb students
I don't like to teach. But do we make that distinction here?
No.
So I'm saying.
No. You keep on telling them again and again.
Again.
Yes.
Till it clicks.
Yes. But they keep on saying, okay, by the time when I say, they say, yeah. If you say yeah,
it means you are known. You are understood.
You should mean and say. That is what I keep on saying.
So same way.
Now compare that
example with satsang. That everyone says yeah.
And question is asked, and the answer doesn't come. Then what did you listen? I'm not talking about you, I'm just
saying in general. Yes. So, when
the realized master
has infinite compassion,
because he is established in that oneness, mirror is established
in its clarity of reflection. Whoever comes, it will reflect that entirely.
So similarly, the teacher, he knows he is established in the truth, he is the truth, he knows the student is also the truth. But the student doesn't know that he is the truth. And the student comes, or the seeker comes, not a seeker, student. Student comes with a doubt to the teacher. Is he the one? Is he realized? Or am I at a wrong door? If I spend 9 years, 10 years with this fellow studying, and then I come to know he is not realized, then I will have wasted my 9 years. I don't know how long I am going to live. All these thoughts go through.
Mm.
Get out of all these thoughts. They are not worthy of thinking. Because it will only create more doubt, more fear, more insecurity. Go with abandonment. Trust that whatever is coming in your life is what is required by you at this very given moment. And when we are in the presence of masters, do not just be an empty... What my teacher
Anuvahanji told me when I went to study. Come with an empty mind, study the scriptures for 2 years, go away with an empty mind.
So when we are in the presence of masters, even today
I do the same thing. When he is here, be the empty.
Empty pot. So, he can pour. But we go there to argue, to judge,
to dictate. Swamiji, ye ek roti aur khao. Swamiji, dawai khao. Swamiji, ab so jao. Swamiji, ye...
But that is also funny. It's not that also anger is not a real anger. Very, it's out of love. You can see that. But we are there in the presence of a realized master, not to see if they are perfect or not. We are there to make our life a perfect one. We are not in front of a fire to check whether the fire is hot or cold. We are there to remove our cold by gaining the warmth from the fire, isn't it?
So be a nobody in front of a teacher.
Then we will be benefited. And when you are benefited,
then automatically the love which is always
in the heart of the teacher, that becomes available to us. The conscious space in which he is roaming around, that becomes available to us in our own self. But that happens because we are there being a
nobody. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om Vakyarthascha Vicharyatam Shuddhishira Pakshasamashriyatam Dustarkatsu Viramyatam Shutimataha Tarko Anusandhiyatam Brahmasmiti Vibhavyatam Harahaha Garva parityajyatam deham matirujyatam budhajanaihi vada parityajyatam vada parityajyatam.
Do not argue with wise men.